Good morning, my dear students. I really hope that everything is very okay with you and with all of yours. Today, we're going to talk about the cost of capital, our last lecture in managerial finance. At the beginning, we need to know what is the meaning of the cost of capital. The cost of capital can be defined as the cost of the firm's financial resources. And here we have the right side of the financial statement or the balance sheet. The whole right side is called the financial structure. The financial structure. But the long term sources of fund in this balance sheet is called the capital structure. The capital structure. For a second time, the long-term sources of fund is called the capital structure. And when talking about the cost of capital, we need to get the cost of the long-term sources of fund for this firm. So when talking about the cost of capital, we in fact are talking about the cost of the long-term financial resources of the firm. And the cost of these long-term sources of fund is called the weighted average cost of capital, WACC, or the weighted average cost of capital. Here, these are the five long-term sources of fund. We have long-term debt, we have bonds, we have preferred stocks, we have common stocks, and we have retained earnings. And let's move ahead or go ahead for knowing how to measure or how to get the cost of the firm's financial structure, the cost of the firm's sources of fund. And let's have this balance sheet for the calendar year ended by 2000. Here we have the balance sheet. We have the balance sheet for the ended year of 2019. As we can see here, we have the asset structure for the sphere at about $24 million or million Egyptian pound, which means that this firm were or was really in need to get a total amount of money of $24 million, because we say that this balance sheet is in thousands of dollars, in thousands of dollars. So the question, or the right question, should be how much this amount of money, how much this amount of money for this firm was costed? How much this firm should pay for getting this total amount of money? And the right definition of the firm's cost of capital can be determined as the lower limit of return that should be required for the firm's capital structure with the goal of maximizing the owner's wealth. One more time. How much this firm should pay as a cost for the total amount of its asset structure or for its capital structure. How much this firm should pay in order to get a total amount of money of $74 million. So we say how much this firm should earn at a lower rate of return. At a lower rate of return that should be required for this total amount of money with the goal of maximizing the owner's wealth, with the goal of increasing or maximizing the market value of the these common stocks of the resident firm. This is the meaning of the cost of capital. So we have long-term debt, we have bonds, we have preferred stocks, common stocks, and retained earnings. And in order to get the weighted average, the what? Weighted average cost of money. How to get it? In fact, at the beginning, we need to get or to measure the cost of the single source of fund. We need to get the cost of these five sources of fund and by multiplying or by weighting these single sources of fund by its proportion and the capital structure and getting the sum or the total amount of these values, we can get the weighted average cost of capital. So at the beginning, we need to measure the cost of each single source, and we need to weight the single source by its proportion and the capital structure. And we're gonna have an example directly for illustrating how to measure the cost of these firm source of fund. At the beginning, we need to get the cost of the long-term debt for this firm. The cost of the long-term debt for this firm. Actually, we have functions that can be depended upon for getting or for measuring the source of each single or the cost of each single source of fund. And for measuring the cost of debt, we say we need to get the after-tax cost of debt. The after-tax cost of debt. So we need data about the tax that this firm should pay for the necessary finance as taxation process rate, and we need to get the coupon rate or the fixed rate that this firm pay for its long debt. We need to get the tax or taxation rate. We need to get the coupon rate or the fixed interest rate for its debt, and by applying this simple equation, we can get the cost of debt. And here, you can say, and you can hear by yourself the total amount of this firm long-term debt is about $15.6 million. $15.6 million. And now let's show how much of interest that this firm is already paying for the bank. Here we have $2 million. We have $2 million. So this firm is already paying $2 million as a fixed payment of interest for its total amount of long term debt for $15.6 million. So we need to measure the cost of long term debt for this firm. So we need to measure the after tax cost of debt as a percentage, once again as a percentage, as a proportion. So we need to apply this equation. We need to apply this equation. The cost of debt is called RI, cost of debt, and we say it's the after tax cost of debt. And now let's apply this equation directly. Let's apply the equation directly. Let's back with the income statement for this firm. We need data about the tax rate, and here we have 40%. This firm is already paying a 40% as a taxation or as tax rate for its gains. So we have T, or the tax rate is 40%, and we have the value of the fixed payments. The fixed payments of interest is about $2 million for a total amount of $15.6 million. So we have, or we need to apply the equation, which means that the cost, or that the after tax cost of this firm's debt is about 7.7%. This is the first item. This is the first item. Or this is the cost of the first source of this firm financial structure. So the long term debt for this firm has been costed merely 7.7%. 7.7%. Like this type or method, we need to measure, or we need to get the cost of the other four sources of fund. We need to get the cost of partners. We need to get the cost of partners. In the case of partners, actually we have more than two types of payments. But you should realize that the money that the firm is paying as a cost of debt is considered a rate of return for the bond holders. A rate of return for the bond holders. So we need, or you should notice, that you have two partners. You have two partners as investors. You have the firm itself, and you have on the other side you have the bond holders. And in the case of the bond holders, we can say that the cost of bond can be measured by getting the yield or the profit that the bond holders is already have or can get from the firm or from the marketplace itself. And in the case of the bond holders, he has two types of returns. He has the fixed payments of interest that he receives from the firm which is issued the bond he already hold, and he also can give another type of return or another type of income. The first type of income that he already has been or has received from the issued or from the firm that issued its bond is called the income gains. Income gains. And these income gains is the fixed or are the fixed payments of interest he already received from the firm. And the second type of income is called the capital gains. Is called the capital gains. And this capital gains is the difference between the selling price of his bond and the purchasing price or the buying price of this bond. So the difference between the selling price and the buying price of the bond he already is holding is called the capital gains. So here we have another equation for measuring the cost of bond. We have another equation for measuring the cost of bond. Here we have income gains, which already is the fixed payments of interests. The fixed payments of interest, in addition to the average capital gains, and the average capital gains in this case, as I just said, is the difference between the selling price and the buying price of this bond. The all are divided by the average capital gains. And for illustrating how to apply this equation and how to measure the cost of bond, we need to show or we need to offer this example. And here, in this example, we say, considering the recent financial statements of the recent firm, if the number of issued bonds were 5.8 million pounds, here we have the number of issued bonds, and we have the market value or the market price for each single bond is about $980, and we have the annual coupon rate of this bond is 9%. And the maturing debt is 20 years, and the flotation costs of this bond is about $20. So we need to get the par value of the firm's bond, and here, as we can notice, that the value of the firm's bond is about $5.8 million, and the number of its bond is $5,800. So we have a par value. We have a par value for each single bond of this firm is about $1,000. By dividing the total value of the total amount of the firm's bonds over the number of its issued bonds, so we have a par value of the firm or a par value of the firm's bonds for about $1,000. But you should notice this $1,000 is belonging to which one of these symbols? This $1,000 is belonging to which one of these symbols? S or ND? Which one? Which one? Now you will hear and you will see by yourself how to apply this equation. And let's go ahead for just another step. How much this firm is pay as a fixed payments of interest? As a fixed payments of interest. Here the firm had issued its bond by price or an initial price which is called par value of $1,000, and the coupon rate for these issued bonds is 9%, which means that each single bond for this firm which has costed the firm $1,000 will be paid 9% as a percentage from this amount. So we have a fixed payments of interests as a value for this firm add 9% from its par value. So we have, or this firm is already paid a fixed payments for each year for the bond holders for each single bond for about $90. So I equals $90. And N, what is the meaning of N? It means the maturing debt. So we have 20 years at the maturing debt for each single bond. So we have 20 years, we have $90, and we have $1,000, and we don't know, up to now, we don't know for whom this amount of dollars should be, S or ND. And here, you have to wonder. If you are this firm's bond holders, or if you are the bond holders of this firm, and the firm is issued your bond by a par value of $1,000, and this $1,000 can't be repaid for you until 20 years in the future. And if you want, or if you have decided to sell this pond, you think that you can sell this pond with a price or with a higher price of this par value? If you want to sell your pond now, and what is the meaning of now? Let's say that now means that just 1 year has been left, or just 1 year has been passed, which means you need to sell your pond now. Do you think that you can sell this pond by a higher price over your $1,000 that you already have paid for the firm? Of course, it's impossible. Why? Because the other investor that want to buy your bond have to wait for another 19 years, on another 20 years to get his money, or to to get his money back from the firm. So he will negotiate you for having a discount for this pond. So you will sell this pond by a lower price. Okay? So here S will be the par value. S will be the par value. And the second simple will refer to the market price of this pond. Market price of this pond. And here at the market price the recent pond can be sold by $900.80. And this amount of money will not belonging to the pond holders. Why? Because he still has to pay a flotation cost for each single pawn for about $20. So this amount of flotation costs that should be excluded from the market price. So the net market price for this pawn will be $900.60. So we have this net price or net market price. And by applying your equation, you're gonna have 5.6% as a cost of the firm's products. So up to now, we have 7.7 as a cost for the long term debt, and we have 5.6% as a cost of bonded. So we have, or up to now, we have two different costs for the firm's long term debt and for the firm's bonded. We have two different costs for these two different sources of fund. And now, what about the cost of the firm's preferred stocks? What about the costs of the firm's preferred stocks? Like these items or sources of fund, we have another costs for the other sources of fund. And at the cost of the preferred stocks, we have another model, or we have another equation for getting the cost of preferred stocks. And for getting the cost of preferred stocks, we should divide the fixed dividends that the firm can pay or is promised the preferred stockholders to pay, divided by the net price. So we need to get a ratio, we need to get a percentage at cost. So we need to divide the fixed payments of preferred stocks dividends divided by the net price of the preferred stocks. And the net price can be got by considering the preferred stocks flotation costs. And let's have another example for illustrating how to measure the cost of preferred stocks. Here, if the market value of the resident firm preferred stocks is about $100, $100, and the fixed cash dividends of these preferred stocks is just $7. And the firm is peering another 5% as another types of courses, as a flotation courses. So we can get the preferred stocks cost in a direct way by using this data as it follows. Here we have $7 as a fixed payments of dividends, and we have a market price of $100, and we have 7% as a flotation cost. So we have 7.3% as a cost of preferred stocks. So up to now we have got the cost of three sources of fund. We have got the cost of long-term debt, we have got the cost of bonds, and we have got the cost of preferred stocks. And we still need to measure the cost of common stock and the cost of retained earnings, the cost of common stocks and the cost of retained earnings. Here at the common stocks we have two types of cost. In the case of the common stocks, we have two extra types of data. The first, we know that the payments of the common stocks dividends are not fixed. They are changeable. They are variable. So we can get the cost of the common stocks for the first year by dividing the common stocks dividends by the end of the first year. So we say D1, dividends by the end of the first year. But here, let's back to the preferred stocks, we say dividends for the simple P, which means in the case of preferred stocks we have fixed payments as dividends. But here, because they are changeable, so we need to get the fixed, not fixed, the changeable dividends for the common stocks by the end of the first year. So we have D1 divided by the net price of the common stocks plus the gross rate. What is the meaning of gross rate? We already know that in the case of the common stockholders, which is already the owners of the firm, we have cash dividends, and we have cash dividends and we have retained earnings. And in the case of the retained earnings, which means that the firm, when achieving a percentage of profit or of gains, the total amount of gains can't be divided as a whole. No, the firm can keep another percentage of these total profits as retained earnings, and by reinvesting this amount of gains or of profits, the firm is expecting to make another gross for its future gains and prices. For its future gains and prices. So we are talking about the impact of the percentage of gains that the firm has been kept to reinvest in its activities. This is the meaning of the impact of the retained earnings in the case of the firm. So we have, when the firm keep percentage from its profits, this amount of profits will be reinvested inside the same firm, achieving another type of growth. This type of growth will be for the prices of the firm's products and will be for the future gains of this firm. So we have another type of growth, which is called G. And for illustrating the meaning of measuring the common stocks causes, we have this example. We have specific data about the firm's dividends by the first year. So we have $5 add the payments of the firm's dividends by the end of the first year. And we have a market price for the common stock at $100, and the firm has been costed $2 for each single common stock as a flotation cost. So we need to get the net price or the net market price. So we have $98 at market net price. And here in the example, we have assumed that the growth rate for this firm is 4%. So we have 9.1% as the annual cost of these firm's common stocks. So up to now, we have four costs for the four single sources of the firm. But unfortunately, we have two types or two models for measuring the cost of the common stocks. The first one is called Jordan model. The second model is called the capital asset pricing model. In the case of the capital asset pricing model, here we have the required rate of return for these common stocks or the required rate of return for the firm's common stocks. And this model says that if you want to get the required rate of return for the firm's common stocks, you should consider at the beginning, you should consider the risk-free rate of return plus the market premium. So this amount or this whole amount is called the market premium. And the market premium can be measured by multiplying the market access return by what? By beta. Peter. What is the meaning of Peter? Peter is the systematic risk, or the market risk. This model is called the capital asset pricing model, So we have the market risk, and we have the market excess return, and the post can be called the market or the risk premium. So we have the risk-free rate of return, in addition to the risk premium, and here as illustrating example, we have assumed that the risk-free rate of return, and in a lot of cases we can say that the treasury tells rate of return is considered the risk-free rate of return. So when talking about the risk-free rate of return, we can say that the rate of return that should be gained over the treasury tells is called the risk-free rate of return, or the rate of return that can be earned, by the governmental bonds. So we have treasury bills and we have the governmental bonds. The bonds can be called risk-free rates of return. Okay? And here we have the market risk or beta at 1 or 100%. And we have the rate of return for the market portfolio, as 10%. And we have here, like this is called risk-free rate of return. So we have 10% as a cost of the firm's common stock. And now we have, actually, we have got two types of costs for the same common stocks. We have 10% and we have 9.8%. And now, which one, can be considered the real cost of this firm's common stocks? It's logically, or by logic, we can select the higher cost. Why? Because of the firm. If the firm has considered the higher cost as real cost of its common stocks, it means that the financial manager, of this firm will do his best, for achieving, a higher rate of return in order to guarantee, or in order to make sure that he will be able to hire to what he will achieve, and he will do his best for achieving a higher rate of return in order to cover a higher cost of capital. So selecting a higher or the higher cost means achieving the owner's wealth, because it will encourage the financial manager for his firm to do his best in order to cover the higher level of cost. And we have another approach. For determining the real cost of this firm's common stocks, when having more than one single cost. And this approach says that we can get the average the average amount of these two causes. So we say 9.1 plus 10 over 2, over 2, and BPOS are right, BPOS are right, but it's more logically to select the higher cost, okay? So we say that up to now we have 10% at a final cost of this firm's common sorts, okay? And now we still have one source of fund left. We still have one source of fund left, which is the retained earnings, okay? And for getting the cost of the retained earnings, and we assume that we are depending upon the historical approach in order to get the weighted average cost of this firm's capital. So we are talking about the historical approach. We are not talking about the expected capital structure. No, we are talking about the historical approach. And in talking about the historical approach, we need to get the weighted average cost of capital for the actually recent capital structure for the firm. So we are talking about the POC values, not the expected capital structure. Okay, you should notice this data. And in the case of measuring WACC, or the weighted average cost of capital, applying the historical approach, we say that the cost of the retained earnings is the same as the cost of common stocks, is the same as the cost of the firm's common stocks. So we have another cost for the retained earnings as a 10%. So we have, up to now, we have four different causes of the firm's sources of fund. We have 10% as a cost of the common stocks and the firm's retained earnings, and we have a different cost for the preferred stocks, we have a different cost for the firm's bonds, and we already have a different cost for the long-term debts of the firm. Okay, so now what about this amount of money? How much this firm should pay as a percentage in order to cover the total amount of its 70,000 or $4 million? How much this firm should pay, and how much this firm should ask at a lower limit of return that should be required in order to maximize owner's wealth. This is the meaning of how much this firm should pay. Okay, and now we have reached to the final step, which means getting the weightings of each single source fund, which means this amount of funds, $15.6 million, is equals, or what about the percentage of this amount of money? We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 sources. So we have the sum or total amount of these four sources. Add the downside Okay? Let's go directly to our example. Okay? Here we have the weighted average cost of capital in order to measure how much this firm should pay. We should get the weighted average cost of capital that we call WACC, and the weighted average cost of capital is the summation of each single source of fund multiplied by its proportion in the capital structure. And here we have these five sources of fund. Here we have their POC values, and you should notice that this firm is not depending upon preferred stocks. Okay, and now here these are the POC values. I think that we have a mistake here. We have a mistake in here. We have the value of the preferred stocks at $1 million, and here we have assumed that it's zero. So you have to modify this amount. But let's say that this amount is zero, which means that this firm is not depending upon the preferred stocks. And let's consider that this amount is zero in order to illustrate how to get or how to measure the weighted average cost of capital for this firm. Okay, here we have these POC values. For long-term debts, we have 15.6 million, and for the bonds, we have 5.8 million, and for preferred stocks, we have zero. We have assumed that it's zero, okay? And at the common stocks, we have $12.5 million, okay? And finally, for the retained earnings, we have $20.4 million. And these are the weights for each single source. So we have the total amount of the five sources is 54.2 million dollars, and the book value for the long term debt is 15.6. So this amount, the 28.6%, can be measured by applying or by dividing this amount over the total sources of the five items. Okay, so by dividing this amount over the total amounts, we get this weight, and the same as for the other sources of fund. And now we have another column. We have another column for the costs of each single source. Okay, long term debt 6%. Let's pack. Oh my god, I'm really sorry. Here we have 7.7. So we have, okay, here we have $1 million, and here we have 11.4, and here we have another Let's apply, let's try to get the right answer for this example.
Here.
Here we have
one.
We have $1,000,000 divided by 54.2. So we have here 1.84, okay, and this amount we have just 21, okay, 0.0, okay, and here we have 7.7, okay, so we have to multiply this proportion by this or by this cost, and we gonna have
here
multiplied by two point two. Here we have 2.2. Okay, and this is right, and this is okay. And here, I think that you can that you can do, or you can modify these numbers by yourself in order to get the weighted average cost of capital. And here, let's have that these numbers are right. These numbers are right. It means that the weighted average cost of capital for this firm will be 8.5% will be 8.5%. You by yourself should modify these figures or numbers in order to get the right answer. In order to get the right answers. Okay? But I just need to say that in order to get the weighted average cost of capital for this firm, you should multiply the proportion of each single source of fund by its cost in order to get the weighted average cost of each single source, which means that you are weighting this cost by its proportion on the capital structure. Here, by multiplying these weights by these costs, and to get the total or the sum. Here, if these numbers are right, you can get the weighted average cost of this firm's capital as 8.4, which means that this firm will pay 8.4 as a cost of this total amount of money, of this total amount of money. And this is how, this is the way you can get or you can measure the weighted average of the cost of this firm's capital. Thank you very much, and see you next semester at the Cobb Williams. Okay, goodbye.